The world's richest city welcomes the world's richest poker tour as the EPT draws to the end of another season.
Well, the EPT Grand Final is the pinnacle of the tour, so that's a feather in your cap. Plus, you're going to make a whole bunch of money.
It offers the chance of achieving poker greatness.
There would be no better way for me to introduce myself to the European poker tour world by winning a marquee tournament like the Grand Final.
It's the title every player wants to win.
It means a lot to win an EPT. It just means like you're one of the best in what you do, and you know you can always be called a champion after that.
It's the definitive event of Season 8, the PokerStars and Monte Carlo Casino EPT Grand Final. Monaco, picturesque, elegant, stylish, decadent. This week it's hosting one of the most prestigious poker events on the planet, the European Poker Tour Grand Final. The game's most ambitious and driven have come from far and wide to stake their claim at poker glory. Last time, Day 1B kicked off with a bang. 394 players took their seats, all hoping that in 6 days' time, they'll have earned the title of Grand Final Champion. Russian pro Maxim Likhov got off to a flyer, ending Jonathan Duhamel's title dreams within the first four levels. While NEPT champion Tom Marchese got lucky as he aims for his first major European title. And out of the field, a whole host of the game's big guns made it through the early stages unscathed. But we've barely started. And now, combined with the field on Day 1A, a total of 665 players have signed up, each paying €10,000, creating a total prize pool of 6.65 million. But it's first prize everyone's eyeing. The Grand Final champ will pocket a staggering 1.5 million euros. Daniel Negreanu has an unprecedented poker CV, but despite everything he's accomplished in the game, a major title in Europe still eludes him.
Well, I haven't won an EPT yet, so for me, winning any EPT would be great, but winning the Grand Final would be just that much better.
Hafiz Khan would no doubt agree. After finishing second to Elki at the 2008 PCA, he still has no major title to his name, and he's looking finally to close the deal.
To win the EPT Monaco would be a dream come true, it really would, and someday I hope I can say that I won it.
Meanwhile, at the secondary feature table, Maria Ho is hoping to show the boys how it's done.
Of course, you know, winning a major title is definitely up there on my list of things that I want to accomplish in poker. Until I get that major win under my belt, I don't think I'll ever be satisfied.
Ambitions are high here in Monaco as we continue our journey towards crowning our next EPT champion. Straight to the main arena as we meet the players at our feature table.
I had, like, I won a couple coin flips. Yeah, I've been short. Being short in a tournament ain't nothing, you know what I'm saying? As long as you got 20 BBs, what? That's what I'm saying. If you got 20, what? I got more than 20 now. I got plenty.
You think if he also finishes second in this event, we're going to see the wrath of Khan?
Well, Hafiz has already got his stack up to nearly 60,000, double what he started with. Negreanu on around 32K. I don't know what he's complaining about being short for. He's around tournament average.
Yeah, that doesn't make any sense at all. He's got like 100 big blinds. It's like talking about dieting in front of a starving person.
Blinds are 150, 300 with a 25 ante. Hafiz Khan folds under the gun. Thomas Gabriel will also muck. Carlos Alvarez gives up the 8-10. Ace 5 for Vasily Fersal.
Perfectly fine for late position. Will you stop that? Hardigan, is that you?
It's Negreanu.
It's a perfectly fine spot for an in position Reese. Seriously, I'm going down there.
He 3 bets to 2100.
Can't whistle.
Yeah, we noticed.
Wish, I mean, I can only fake whistle.
We got it.
Re-raise, right?
This 4-bet is clearly designed to punish Daniel for that annoying noise!
Whistling aside, this is part of Daniel's small ball strategy. He re-raised so small that when he gets just called, he'll win the pot a bunch of the time. In cases like this, he won't lose much when he gets re-raised.
He gives it up.
Good 4-bet by Forsau.
I had a feeling you were doing that. I said, I'm gonna wait for you later on the final table. We'll get there and then I'll go pow! Final table. Now it's too early.
This table. Raise, raise, raise.
Okay.
No. No table.
No three, yeah.
Boy, Daniel checked out of that conversation like he was folding out a turn.
Our secondary feature table plays host to two members of Team Pro, Johnny Lodden and Lex Veldhaus.
Johnny Lodden is also the inspiration behind the game Johnny Lodden Thinks, where contestants gamble on what Johnny Lodden thinks. Yeah, that's a real thing. And I guess we know what Lex thinks of Johnny as a player.
Well, Martin Finger's no slouch. He won EPT Prague this season for 720,000 euros. He's facing a 3-bet from Maria Ho.
Shaping up to be something similar to the last hand, only this time the re-raise is coming from the small blind.
Those aren't calling chips. Martin Finger 4-bets to 3,800.
Will Maria fold to the 4-bet like Daniel? Even if you got a big pair like 10s and decide to get it in, you could be up against, say, jacks, and like that, you're out. Tournament poker is terrifying, and so is Martin Finger.
Maria Ho will fold.
Ho lets it go. Though probably not mentally, women can be known to hold a grudge.
Martin Finger adds 2,500 to his stack, which is currently the biggest stack in the room. He is the tournament chip leader, closing in on the 100,000 chip mark. Vasily Fursau, who we saw take that pot off Negreanu, is third on the leaderboard. Also in the top 10, William Torsen, Johnny Lodden, and Jason Mercier. Let's catch up with Jason, who's sharing a table with another EPT champion, Kevin McPhee. And we've got pro-on-pro action here.
There's a flush draw out there on this board, not much else.
Kevin bets 13.25. Jason makes the call. The six of spades on the turn.
Well, that flush card came in.
Kevin checks and Jason checks behind. Ten of diamonds on the river.
Kevin bet flop, check, turn, bets river. My guess is he's got a strong, showdownable hand, but just not one he thought he could get three streets with.
2,775. Very specific.
Jason called flop, checked the turn, maybe wanted a cheap showdown.
He folds. Kevin wins a decent-sized pot. A little bit below average. Let's see how his girlfriend's getting on.
I don't care what the numbers say. Liv Bari is not below average.
Let's check out other female players in the field.
Vanessa Russo's recently single, which means I've been even more recently rejected. Fatima DeMello may not have any bracelets, but she's got an Olympic gold medal. How many of those you got, Helmuth? One of the few girls in poker I've never hit on because she terrifies me. She'd send me home in a body bag.
Who's your favorite lady on the tour? Make sure you tag your response, EPT Grand Final.
Mine's Lady Luck.
Back to the feature table where Daniel has deuce four suited. Raises to 675.
A little loosey-goosey. Daniel's a rich Canadian, so at least he's wearing designer flannel. There goes one of Daniel's massive outs.
Hafiz Khan has King 10 suited on the button.
His hand is most certainly playable in position.
He calls. Queen 5 folded in the small blind. Ace Jack for Thomas Gabriel in the big blind.
A good hand, but no reason to bloat the pot with it out of position when you could be dominated.
He calls.
Daniel's gonna need some help on this flop, either by hitting or at least the other guy's missing.
8-8-3 with two hearts. No one has hit. Action's been checked to Daniel.
925.
He bets 925.
Not much reason for Hafiz Khan to stick around here. Whoa.
He calls. Gabriel folds. Heads up to the turn.
Years ago, Daniel would have just won this hand on the flop, but people just don't give up anymore.
And Khan pairs his king on the turn.
They float, they bluff raise, sometimes they call down with ace or king high, which is now top pair.
Goes check, check. Six of diamonds on the river.
Daniel opted to not double barrel. It's pretty much a huge brick on the river. Daniel's got four high.
1850.
He's gonna bluff it. 1850.
Should be an easy call. I assume that's why he checked the turn, keep the pot small, and induce a bet.
I have pair of eights with a king, six, and a three. No, a four. I'm lying. Sorry. I also have a four. You hit the king, darn it. I was trying to pretend I did. Give me 200 change.
At least there's change.
I was trying to pretend I had the king.
Thought I might be good on the flop.
You were, way ahead.
Yeah. Four deuce off, huh?
Suited.
Oh, suited, off. Okay.
Come on now, okay, pay attention.
Okay. If it's suited, it's all right.
Four deuce off, don't be ridiculous, it was suited. Daniel's obviously a nit. Tough level guy.
If you want to play in an EPT event, go to PokerStars.com, where there are qualifiers every day. Welcome back to Monaco and the PokerStars and Monte Carlo Casino EPT Grand Final. In the heart of Casino Square is one of the world's oldest gambling establishments. Built in 1856, it's rich in history. Two players looking to make history in 2012 are Daniel Negreanu and Hafiz Khan. Both have just fallen short of winning an EPT and would love nothing more than to secure this prestigious title. These two have already tangled, so expect some entertaining antics on our feature table.
I mean, would that line ever work on a girl? You know, like, hey, we're nothing but mammals. Why don't we do it like they do on the Discovery Channel? Like, go to a bar and try that pickup line on a girl?
Doesn't work. And that's all I'm going to say about that.
We have an all-in on one of the outer tables. Tom Marchese has Jason Duval at risk. It's a flip.
Come on.
Duval finished 8th in EPT Madrid this season.
Come on.
His hand's best. I'd be careful about asking anything to come on other than a deuce.
Yeah. You didn't want to river that set.
Oh, this poor guy. He's so upset he can only speak in high-pitched beeps. It's terrible.
Marchese rivers a straight and eliminates the Canadian.
That boy is devastated. Hope you feel good about yourself, Marchese.
Well, the last time we saw Maxim Leekov, he was the boss at our feature table. Involved in a hand here against Italy's Marco Della Tomasina.
Della, too many letters in his name.
A flop. King, deuce, jack with two hearts.
Flush and Broadway draws galore.
Leekov's in position. Della Tomasina leads for 3,000.
Lots of hands and button raise and three betting ranges that are all over this board.
Leekov makes the call. The turn. There's another jack.
Doesn't add any draws, but it does change some things. Mainly second pair just became the near nuts.
Della Tomasina checks. And Leekov moves all in.
This could be any kind of draw or made hand. Don't think he's got total air, though.
Quick call. Della Tomasina has kings full. Leekov has a jack.
It's a cooler. He's dead to the case, jack.
He doesn't hit it. And we lose Maxim Leekov.
Well, it was cooler-ish. Max got a little loosey-goosey pre-flop and decided to peel the flop, only instead of turning gin, he took it on the chin.
From table hero to zero in the space of just a couple of levels.
Looks like we've come over just in time to catch Eugene shoving off. Catch aloft, more like miss aloft.
Well, let's see how his best buddy's getting on. Elke involved in a pot against fellow Frenchman Darko Stojanovic.
Elke's made a bet here. He's got a bit of a reputation of being a wild man. I would expect him to gamble early in these hands, but only make big bets toward the end if he's got something.
Elke bets the river.
Well, there's a big bet. He's practically all in.
And Stojanovic will make the call. Showdown. Stojanovic tables 8-9 for trips.
8-9 is going to be good.
Oh, Elke has the same hand.
Told you. Good for both of them. Gotta wonder what one of those guys was doing in the hand with 9-8 off, let alone both of them. Elke's Elke. What's your excuse, Stojanovic?
You know what they say, Joe.
Everybody loves a chopped pot.
You got it. Need to work on the delivery a little bit.
I'm not a singer by nature.
To the secondary feature table where Lex Veldhaus is all in.
You're that bad, man.
For his last 6.5K.
What you gonna do?
Yeah, I gamble for you.
Oh, you slow rolling me?
Oh. We have an ace.
Ace king for Lex. Kings for London!
Oh wow.
Nasty slow roll.
Don't punish me, God.
Yes, punish him. Punish him for the slow roll.
No. No.
Oh yeah.
No. You see, I need an ace.
Oh, he needs an ace. I see.
No three.
Lex picks up some wheel outs.
No!
Boom!
Headshot.
That'll teach you, Lodden.
Do you believe in karma, Johnny? Because I do. From now on. Thank you.
God.
Thanks for donation.
Lex doubles up, but he'll still be pretty short.
Painful cash.
Thank you.
Pretty sure karma is supposed to be a two-way street. I'd shut up.
What are you saying? I'm counting your chips. I can't hear you.
Well, if karma's real, neither one of these guys is walking out of here a winner.
So our main feature table where the action is on Hafiz Khan. 8-10 suited. And he's raising to 700.
A bit loose from early.
Edouard Kebzu has A6 suited. He'll make the call from the hijack.
Also a tad loose with so much action behind.
Thomas Gabriel calls from the cutoff with Jack 9 suited.
Less loose.
Carlos Alvarez folds the button. Vasily Fursow, King 7 suited in the small blind.
He's getting okay pot odds to call with a suited king.
He calls what he does, and Daniel Negreanu will call from the big blind with A7 offsuit.
Now, even though Daniel was getting ridiculous pot odds, some would say it's tough to make hands like this profitable in this spot.
Daniel flops top pair, and he bets 1,000.
Donk bet. Weird.
Gets rid of the original razor. Does not get rid of Edward Kebzu. He makes the call. Gabriel and Fursow both muck.
That's you and me.
Yeah.
Two of clubs on the turn.
Doesn't really change much.
You know what that means?
575. It should be 600.
Oh, I didn't have 600.
I give you, right? Here we go.
Daniel makes a classic 1/10 pot bet. Not really sure what's going on here.
Three of clubs on the river.
5,700.
That's a much bigger bet.
I know you don't have a four. You don't play the little ones. You always play the big ones.
Pot-sized bluff, I think, even though he is value betting.
You have an ace and a 10, is my guess.
He's trying to take him off a bigger ace.
There you go. Let's see what happens.
Oh, God.
Kebzu calls.
I have an ace and a 7.
You're good.
You win.
Oh, okay. Oh! I didn't know it was a value bet. I'll take it. I was so bluffing just there. That was a big bluff.
Nice blue with bad, nice blue with
like
bad
good bluff.
Hand.
I was trying to bluff him off ace 10.
So sick.
Good hand, good
thank
hand.
Thank you, thank you.
I'd like to see how much faster his bluff would have been snapped off had Kebzu actually had ace 10. You know, we should add to this stat that he's up at least 5 figures on bets involving Elky and Lex kicking and punching each other.
Over to the secondary feature table. Well, we've been joined by a spectator.
Oh, look. It's the one guy in poker who's as big a lech as me. And look who he just so happens to be standing behind. It's a girl. Two of them, actually.
Gus Hansen railing Maria Ho.
Are you allowed to say that?
She's raised to 800. Johnny Lodden's made the call. Vyacheslav Goryachev also calls.
Like, you're going to try to take my chips, but you want to take your chips? It's like food chain right now. I feel like I'm at the bottom.
I'm sure any of these guys would be fine with that.
Well, Paul Testud has also called out of the big blind, so we're going 4-way to this flop. Which is 4-5-7 with 2 hearts.
Check. Haven't seen a flop this wet since Waterworld.
Actions on Maria. She was the pre-flop aggressor. She gives up the betting lead and checks. Johnny Lodden going for chips. He bets 2,225. Goryachev and Testud both muck.
There's just so many possibilities on this board with the pot going to the flop several ways.
Maria looks back at her cards. And decides that she is all in. Snap called by Lodden. Maria's got 2 overs and a flush draw. Top set for Lodden.
No, I didn't want to see flush draw.
Her overs are dead, but her heart will go on.
Please.
And she hits on the turn. Lodden has a redraw. Needs the board to pair. It doesn't. Mariaho doubles up.
If it makes him feel any better, that turn card brought the whole world. Even a 3 or an 8 would have beat him.
Really? I'm sure. I think it's funny.
It's about as funny as the Big Bang Theory. Take that for what it's worth.
Not sure how Maria feels about receiving the attentions of Gus Hansen, but she'll be happy with that double up.
I'm Maria Ho, and I'm from Arcadia, California. I got into poker in college, I think like many people do. A lot of my guy friends loved the game, and they had a home game. And of course, the very first time I played, I beat all of them. So naturally, I thought it was just made to play this game. And obviously, I learned the hard way that, you know, there's a lot more to it than just luck. So I just kind of got bitten by the poker bug, and I started playing more and more recreationally in college. And by the time I graduated, I decided to take it up for a living. But now it's been 7 years that I've been playing professionally, and you know, I've just never looked back, and luckily it's worked out really well for me. I think I haven't been to many EPTs because the truth is I'm lazy to travel. And living in California, it takes, you know, 12 hours to get to this side of the world. There would be no better way for me to introduce myself to the European poker tour world by winning a marquee tournament like the Grand Final. Of course, I'm just taking it day by day. It's still early and, you know, there's a lot of poker to be played, but I feel really confident that I'm good enough to win, and hopefully things will go my way.
You know, we're pretty spoiled as a society when we complain that it takes 12 hours to go 6,000 miles. Wah!
Blinds are up 200, 400 with a 50 ante, and as we head back to the feature table, we're going to sweat with Daniel Negreanu. We will only see his hole cards on this next hand. Hafiz Khan is under the gun. Looks like he wants to play.
Cool little beat.
He raises to 900.
A first position raise, so we're going to have to give this a modicum of respect.
How much respect are we giving this call from Edward Kebzu?
Meh.
Daniel's on the button and has pocket jacks.
If I know Daniel, he'll make a smallish 3-bet. Jacks are too good of a hand to just call with, even to a raise under the gun. Plus, we'll often pick up Kebzu's dead money if he folds.
Daniel does re-raise, makes it 2650 total. Victor Ramden gives up his small blind. Anatoly Gurtovoy folds out of the big blind. Action back on Khan. And he will 4-bet to 5,900.
Well, this just got serious. For most people, ace-king suited is going to be the bottom of their range here.
Kebzu's out of the way.
Still, we can't fold.
Daniel makes the call, and we go heads up to the flop. Nearly 14K in the middle already. And a 4-6-9 flop.
Pretty good flop for two jacks, assuming we're not up against aces, kings, or queens, which is a fairly big part of most four betting ranges.
Khan continues for 5,500.
This is starting to smell more and more like a big pair, although ace king would still have to continue in that spot. There's not a ton of draws out there for Khan to be semi bluffing, so we pretty much still have to call here. Maybe we can just hit a jack and simplify all this, please.
Daniel calls and now has less than a pot-sized bet behind. The turn is another low card, the 5 of clubs.
And that makes his board far less dry, but in a 4-bet pot, we shouldn't really be up against those kinds of cards.
Khan does not barrel, he checks.
Good spot to check behind, get to a cheap showdown. I think with this one of a board, Khan would be unlikely to check a good hand, so I'm all for checking here and calling the river. Well, don't worry, I'm sure Daniel knows what he's doing.
He bets small, 3750.
Okay, that bet was for a seventh the size of the pot. The con of making a bet like this is that you give your opponent the chance to blow you off your hand. The pro is... I'm not sure what the pro is.
All right, I guess he found out cheaper than most.
Khan bet enough to put Daniel all in. Daniel mucks the jacks. Khan had king three.
Six semi-bluff.
Three card and then hit a set on the river, but I was like, no, I'll pay 3750. If he can raise bluff here, that's just like, I'll bow.
No, I had it.
I figured you had aces the whole time, and I still paid till then.
I'm not going to be the one that tells him. You know what he'll say? Khan!
As we head to the outer tables, looks like this will be the last hand of the level. Players about to go on break. Salvatore Bianco has checked the river. Elke checks behind. Elke shows a busted draw. Bianco, a pair of tens.
And he throws his cards at the dealer. And that dealer had only 2 days to retirement. Sad.
Alki letting his emotions get the better of him. An uncharacteristic lapse in that cool demeanor. So the players are going on break, we are doing the same, and the action continues here on day 1B of the EPT Grand Final. Night has fallen here at the PokerStars and Monte Carlo Casino EPT Grand Final, and some familiar faces have already bitten the dust. Earlier, we saw Eugene Kachalov and Maxim Likov depart, and two former EPT champs have joined them on the rail. Italy's Salvatore Bonavena and Germany's Sebastian Ruthenberg won't be adding a second title to their CVs here in Monaco, while Jason Mercier, Kevin McPhee, Liv Marie and Sandra Neuox are previous winners still in the running to claim a second EPT trophy. While we're missing one EPT winner, Elke has received a one-orbit ban for throwing his cards at the dealer just before the break.
I'm not exactly sure what planet Elke's from, so the orbit length could vary.
At our feature table, Daniel Negreanu is not having an easy time, playing around half his starting stack. It's been folded to him in the hijack. He's got Queen Jack offsuit.
950.
And he's raising.
It's a min plus raise, as he is wont to do.
Queen 10 off for Gertevoy on the button.
We know Gertevoy has dominated, but he could take a peek at this in position if he wanted. Tight is right.
The Russian folds. King 10. For Hafiz Khan in the small blind.
While King 10 is better than Queen 10, out of position, that's usually more of a spot for a 3-bet or a fold.
He calls, and Edward Kebzu, despite being short stacked, will call out of the big with A7.
Usually an obligatory hand to defend with, but not sure with his stack.
King 6-3. Khan takes the lead with top pair. Both the blinds check to Daniel.
Daniel totally whiffed.
1250.
He continues, 1250.
Khan not going anywhere.
He calls.
This is the driest flop I've seen since the invention of lying. So when Khan calls you a top pair, Daniel should probably just shut it down.
Kebzu gets out of the way, heads up to the turn. Two of clubs.
Neither player improves. Fairly inconsequential flush draw developed.
Check, check. And the jack of spades on the river.
Bad card for Daniel. Looks like Khan's looking to take him out on a date for Value Times Day.
2-6.
What can you have here outside of the king? Which king do you have?
Spades.
Is that king 10 of spades again?
Guy's good, except he's still gonna call.
King 10 of spades, or king 10 of diamonds. Yeah, right? Or king 10 of hearts.
All good guesses. This is gonna be classic Daniel when he calls, though.
He calls.
Why does it have to be suited?
Oh, just king 10? Okay. Why do I tell people what they have and then pay? It's pretty stupid.
Story checks out.
Yeah. It was the only hand I can come up with that he had, too. It was exactly king 10. But yeah, I still want to see
like,
it.
That was like
curiosity.
FML.
I sleep well at night, though. Play that much. Sleep good.
And if he keeps making calls like that, he'll be getting to bed pretty early.
So Daniel got it right that time, but still made the call. In an earlier hand, he got it wrong and folded the best hand. So what was he thinking?
I was on the button, it was 900 to me. I decided to put in a healthy raise with two jacks to 2650. Figuring I'm just gonna win it before the flop, or maybe get the weaker player to call so we can play heads up. Now Hafiz, to my surprise, makes it 5900, and I really felt like he was strong. So I have him down to like either queens, kings, or aces, or ace, king. So realistically, it's probably a spot where I could have just folded, but I thought, you know what, let me see if I can snap a jack, win a big pot, and double up, and you know, really have a shot in the tournament. So I called. Now the flop came 964, and he bet 5,500, which he's gonna do with ace king or a big pair. But once again, I really felt like my read was that he had the big pair, so I should have folded, but instead I decided to call and see what he does in the turn. Now the turn card is another complete blank, and he decides to check. Well, that doesn't mean necessarily that it doesn't have aces or kings, because he's gonna do that with that hand as well. My fear was if I checked, then on the river he might bet something like 8,000 and puts me in a tough spot. So I decided to bet 3,750. When he moved all in, I'm like, okay, you have aces, duh. And it didn't take me much thought because I'd already planned on folding, so as soon as he made the raise, I'm like, you got me. I'm 100% certain he had aces or kings. There's no way he didn't have me beat. So I'm not gonna be, if he somehow didn't, I'd be in absolute shock.
But I guess we better send an ambulance to Daniel's house. I guess you could say he got caught up in a real con job. Am I right?
Check.
Hello. Hello? He got conned, y'all.
Out on the secondary feature table, four-way action. Maria Ho is checked. Johnny Lodden will bet 4,000 in the middle. He makes it roughly half pot.
This board's drier than a pack of beef jerky.
Goryachev and Carvin both fold. Decision back on Maria Ho.
Lodden's bet more than half the pot. He was into three players after raising early. This is gonna look pretty strong.
Maria looks back at her hand and folds.
Here in Monaco, they say pass instead of fold, which is the same thing, only slightly more expensive.
Johnny Lodden had a four.
The nuts.
Two-thirds of his stack, and then shows a bluff, you know, in a single raise pot. And then in a pot that doesn't matter, you be all cool and you show a bluff.
He didn't show a bluff.
No, he just showed me that I wasn't. I did the right thing by folding because he was never gonna lay down bottom pair there. He's like, good fold. Don't even try it.
Could have had a set of fours.
On the outer tables, we've lost a former champion, Mark Telcher, KO'd by Annette Oberstadt.
Nice to see Annette on the EPT. I think her screen name's got to be Annette 22 or 23 by now.
She's back amongst the big stacks. Fifth in chips overall with close to 100,000. Another female player doing well is Anna Marquez, seventh on the leaderboard. Hafiz Khan, ninth in chips in the tournament, and he's the chip daddy at our feature table. Line's still 200, 400. Action has been folded to Khan, under the gun plus two. Ace-queen off. He raises to 900. Ace-king for Edward Kebzu.
When you've got ace-king against a player as live as Hafiz Khan, you've got to three-bet it.
2,500.
For half his stack.
Huh. Would have expected him to just get it in right there.
Passed around to Vasily Fursow. 8-5 off, that'll go in the muck. Daniel gives up the big blind, so it's back on Hafiz Khan.
Now you'd expect Hafiz would put him in the rest of the way. Nope.
He calls. 10-4, 10 flop.
All right, well, if Khan's gonna stop and go every flop, I guess calling's okay, and still no.
They both check. King on the turn.
Well, I see where this is going. Yeah, what he said.
I gotta see it now. Otherwise, I won't be able to see it.
How could you not?
He has to call.
Ace King over here.
Instead of getting the money in as a 3-1 dog, Khan got it in as a 9-1 dog. Tough to do that.
Oh, well, it was the same result.
Oh, you need a jack. Whatever.
Don't say that.
Well, that's what he needs.
Yeah.
It's coming.
I'm thinking
that
in my head anyway.
Oh, that is deuce.
He does need a jack. And he gets it! Nice job, Daniel.
Sick.
Okay.
Sorry, my man. Bad luck.
Okay.
Bad luck.
I don't think I could save, but I was going to get it in pretty anyway.
So Edward Kebzu takes the walk of shame.
And this guy's having a pretty good day.
I've been playing poker for, I would say, about 6-7 years. And I've had success where I've done well in tournaments, and then I also play cash games. I got second in the PCA in 2008 to Elke, who got first, which is kind of bittersweet. First time I played live, and I went all the way and got second. And I don't know, experience like that is kind of surreal. It doesn't sink in that moment, but you know, the months after that, you realize what just happened. And I don't know, I just feel blessed and lucky to go through that. The table with Daniel and Victor, it's a fun table. I have position on them. So, you know, I'm able to take advantage of some things where if they're playing too many hands, you know, with position, I can take advantage of that and accumulate chips. Daniel always keeps it lively at the table, so, and he's a nice guy, and so is Victor, he's a great guy, he's a friend of mine, so I love playing with both of them.
To
win the EBT Monaco would be a dream come true. It really would. It's one of the best tournaments of the year, one of the top two or three tournaments of the year. And in our profession, that's next to winning the World Series of Poker main event. You know, EBT Grand Final is the next best thing. So someday, I hope I can say that I won it.
Oh, I'm so glad we can be your next best thing just because we don't have beef jerky. Brutal.
Pocket aces for Vasily Fursow.
Fursow, first to act.
Raises to 1,025. Folded around to Hafiz Khan, and with 10-3 offsuit, he is raising?
Oh boy. This is when the power of running good starts to go to your head.
He 3-bets to 2,700.
You simply cannot win every hand of a tournament.
Back on Fursow, who immediately 4-bets to 6,625.
This was an under-the-gun raise and then a 4-bet. Khan should know that he means business. This would definitely be the bad kind of button clicking.
He compounds his error by 5-betting to 16K.
Click! I'm gonna be nice and say that this play is really, really, really bad.
And there's the 6-bet from Fursow. Get the message.
Should be time for Khan to kick it on back to Seti Alpha 5. Nope.
He calls. Well, he does have position. I'm looking for a positive. I'm sorry, I can't find one.
He was getting okay pot odds. Oh, man.
Well, surprise, surprise. Hafiz Khan does not improve on the flop.
This is a really innocuous flop for two aces.
Fursow continues. This is the battle of the two big stacks at the table, by the way.
Teeny tiny bet.
Khan calls. There's now 82,000 in the middle.
Sweet float, brah.
And a 10 on the turn.
Not a great turn for two aces.
Oh.
But he shoves anyway.
How much?
Why are you even asking?
You're not gonna believe what I have, my man.
Nope.
Thinking about calling you, though.
That would be amazingly bad. Hafiz is mostly playing by feel here and is likely all juiced up by how hot he's running and not really thinking about much else.
Should just fold to the flop.
Ding!
Try pre-flop.
Fursow's just playing his hand and hoping to get paid off by the guy in the sunglasses who's in every pot. He's got no idea how badly he wants a call.
Unbelievable. I have fold.
Yeah.
For the bluff.
No bluff.
Well, yeah, they don't need to see it. Just played it bad, really bad. I thought he was monkeying around pre-flop.
Pretty sure only one of you was monkeying around.
Nice hand, my man.
Khan did about half his stack in that hand. What do you reckon? A case of positive tilt? Tag your comments, EPT Grand Final. Players drawing to a close on day 1B of the PokerStars and Monte Carlo Casino EPT Grand Final. And a few familiar faces look set to make it through the day. Barring a major catastrophe, Super High Roller champ Justin Bonomo will be back for day 2, as will fellow Americans Chris Moneymaker and Faraz Jucker, along with some of Europe's big guns, Marcel Lusk, Dario Minieri, and Pierce Hines. One player who needs a bit of help is Daniel Negreanu. He's had a torrid time at the feature table, mostly at the hands of Hafiz Khan. Kid Poker's down to just 6,000 chips and needs some assistance from Lady Luck.
Lady Luck, another chick who won't return my phone calls.
Lines up to 250-500 with a 50 ante. Daniel's under the gun, ace 9.
Looks like a fine hand to go broke with.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
All in.
Oh. Finito. Russia's calling.
Well, what's Russia got?
King, queen suited.
If Gurdjieff would dominate it, Daniel maybe would have just raised rather than shove.
I like to play with you.
Oh, maybe somebody else will double me.
Personally, I never want to call with ace 9.
I need more chips.
Not me.
Gabriel has the same hand.
Six dimes, bro. Dallas. Thomas Dallas Scott.
That's Thomas Gabriel. And this would be a much looser call than it would be a shove.
Eugene Fowler.
He does call.
Especially with action behind.
He's the original bro.
Well, I have two kings.
Good one!
Kings?
Yeah, that's no good.
King, queen.
Ha! I'm suited. Free roll.
No,
well, not free roll, not yet.
Two flush draws,
yeah. That all Russian is optimist.
I like my two flush draws. So.
You like your hand? I like it. Let's bet more on the side. Come on. 5,000 euro on the side. We can't do that on TV.
This guy's not running for, right?
You got a piece of me. Spade, spade, I win! Sweet. There's no way you can win now. Can you feel it? Like, the karma's so obvious that there's like, they're all spades. The burn card's a spade. Everyone coming is a spade. They're gonna be spade, spade. It's guaranteed. I'll bet even money I make this flush right now. There's no way I'm gonna miss it. Spade, spade.
He misses it.
Oh, what the heck?
Genuine shock.
What a sick beat that would have been if I was against him. That flop, and he's got king, queen. Okay. This come on, spade. It should be spade. Calling with this garbage. This Americans today.
Spade.
I would have beat you too. Oh. I told you for sure. I win. I felt it.
Cool.
Huh? At least you could afford it.
Daniel doubles up to about a quarter of the average. Daniel's seen 64 hands at our feature table, and he's played 22 of those hands, which is fairly high at a full table. As you can see, he hasn't fared too well, losing 17 of those 22 hands for a win rate of a whopping 23%. He's only had two premium hands in that time, and the only one that held up was pocket aces. Daniel's obviously a great player, but when you play as many weak hands as he does, it's easy to run up against dominating hands that cause you to make expensive second best ones.
We've got action on our secondary feature table. Maria Ho opened, Lex Veldhaus 3-bet. Maria Ho is now 4-bet, enough to put Lex all in.
All right, Han Solo.
He calls. He was right to have a bad feeling. His ace-queen dominated by Maria Ho's ace-king.
Tough to get away from ace-queen in that spot with that chip stack. Really not much either of them could do.
And he's drawing pretty, pretty thin.
Ace-queen is in real trouble now. He had backdoor spades.
Good luck, good luck.
But no. How about a parting shot for Johnny Lawton? No?
Maria Ho having knocked out Lex. He's close to averaging chips. Lines are going up to 300-600 with a 75 ante. And Will Molson has just joined our feature table.
Don't let the bedhead fool you. Molson Golson is a high roller specialist.
Action on Alexi Fursau with pocket queens.
This guy's kind of a card rack, huh?
Daniel has tens.
Bye, Daniel.
Ow, he says ow.
Another standard shove from Daniel.
10, 13, 14, 6 and a quarter. 14,000, 6 and a quarter. And the plan is to end with 31,625. I got 45 minutes to do that. And this is step one.
Step one toward the exit, unfortunately.
On my way.
If I, my God, no TV, I'm fault.
Okay.
But I show TV, no fault.
No, I see. Sorry. Okay, you have good hand? Sure. Very good, I have tens. Nothing I can do. Big pair, big pair. I think it's time for me to play the next tournament.
I'd be careful making that hand motion to a Belarusian.
But I did hit tens a lot. Tens seem to hit a lot. Ha! Oh,
wow. And he hits this time.
Keep coming.
Oh my gosh.
Diamond.
You folded it.
Really? You folded a 10? Oh, wow.
One out.
He had a 10. So if you put a queen, then I can go.
Queen
or diamond. Yes, diamond. Diamond or queen?
King diamond.
How do you say king diamonds in Russian?
Next. King
how do you say king diamonds? How do you say?
Karol.
Karol. Karol diamond. How do you say diamond?
Boop.
Boop Karol. Niet. Diamond's a good one. Oh, three. Okay.
So 10, 13.
14, 6 and a quarter.
Some people run good and some people double up Daniel. At least he makes it somewhat fun to lose to him.
Yeah. 30,700.
Back in the game.
After getting super lucky and doubling up twice.
What can you do?
Not much. If the hands had been reversed, it probably would have played the exact same way.
We're heading out into the field where Elke is all in. He's been called by Tom Marchese.
I bet the dealers probably got it in for Elke at this point. I saw a picture of him up in their break room with a line through it.
Elke with pocket fives, Marchese with ace jack. It's a flip. A slow reveal. Elke's still in front.
Looking good so far for the Elkster.
But a jack on the turn. Marchese takes the lead. And no five on the river. Elke heads for the exit.
There we go. There's the classy Elke we know and love.
Tom Marchese, the beneficiary of his chips. The American now has more than 100,000. On the secondary feature table, Johnny Lodden calls a bet of 5,100 on the turn.
There are a lot of draws on that turn, but that deuce couldn't be any bigger of a brick.
Lodden checks again. Will Martin Finger bet again? Yes, he does. 12,000.
If Martin were semi-bluffing the turn, there's a good shot he missed this river. Any pair could be good here.
He calls. It's a showdown. Trip jacks for Martin Finger.
Any pair, not good. Whoops.
Martin Finger rakes in that pot as day 1B draws to a close, but we have an all-in at our feature table. Anatoly Gurtovoy is the player at risk with kings. He's been called by Vasily Fursau with ace-king.
Fursau with another big hand.
Anybody have ace? You know? Ace for me.
This guy.
Gurtovoy in good position to double up here.
Yeah, still two more. I think you're okay. That's my feeling inside is you're fine. But if I'm not, you know.
Just has to fade an ace on the river.
Eight of clubs, I think.
I'm sure Fursau's wishing he would stop picking up such good hands.
Oppa!
Yeah, there you go.
Gurtovoy gets the double.
Wait, what's Fursau up to here?
Flash.
What? Oh.
He switched the kings.
The old switcheroo.
No, he flips it on you.
That was so cruel. Hook, line, and sinker.
That one's got a perfect. Oh, he didn't see it. That was so good.
Taking a page from my book, if you can't win, get a laugh.
That was a good one.
Could ask police.
Seriously, that's not cool. Fursau is going to jail.
That's the joy of covering this tournament from the very beginning. You get all the fun of day one. And the day ends with Anatoly Gurtovoy among the chip leaders after that double up. And after eliminating Elky, Tom Marchese is also one of the 10 biggest stacks. Suffice to say, Daniel Negreanu is not in the top 10. But he's going through to day two.
It was a bit of a grind. I just nothing seemed to really be working. All my bluffs were mistimed. My garbage hands were not hitting, and it's nice when those do, but it just seemed like I was running into hands. I'm just happy to still be in. I got lucky with tens against queens, so anything from here on is just gravy.
Next time, superstar Phil Ivey makes his return to the EPT. The girls are out in force with Liv Bari and Annette Oberstad taking center stage.
I think it's going to be a good season for me, at least I hope so.
And the old school boys show the new generation they've still got it.
If they would play old school after the flop, they won't stand a chance.
What an old school table we got here.
Day two is more than just another day in Monaco.